He was a great guy. Supposed to go home in January and got killed in November. It was November 4th. But like I say, his first guy I met over there, he was pretty good. Pretty good guy. Real good guy.
Hitting Vietnam, to be able to do that, include them in our mission was a big deal for me. I'm the daughter of a World War II veteran, but I'm also the little sister of three Vietnam veterans. So I grew up in that era, so that was a big deal for us.
When Stars and Stripes Honor Flight took its first flight, it was just a few years after the World War II Memorial opened.
We have a great sense of urgency to fly as many as possible. The World War II Memorial took 60 years to build, so they couldn't go before.
Now, fast forward to the 50th flight, there were World War II vets on the flight, there were Korean War veterans on the flight, but the majority of veterans on this flight were Vietnam veterans.
Inocencio Villarreal Jr., they call me Inno for short. I was in the Army, drafted in 1969. The 101st, you know, it's historic, the Screaming Eagle. I feel very fortunate that I was born late enough where you don't want to be there between 63 and 69. This was basic here, training. Well, when I got there, you get acclimated to the weather. It's about a 2-week process, and then you finally go to your unit. We traveled a lot, Eshaw Valley. Saw a lot of, not to say action, but enough to make me feel lucky. One time, the worst was in 1970, November. We got ambushed. Three guys killed, four wounded. In fact, one of the guys killed in that ambush was my platoon lieutenant, his radio man, and this other guy. And that was probably the most hectic 48 hours of my life. They brought in the world that night and just blew the top of this hill off, but a little late for us. When I got back, it was hard, but then I don't sweat the little stuff anymore. There's things I wish I'd have done different over there, and there's things that I wouldn't change. It's just, you know, it's life.
He has pictures and like photo albums and stuff like that, so that's the only time he ever really says anything, but other than that, he doesn't talk about it at all.
I'm excited to have her go, because she's at that age where she'll understand it a little more. And hopefully be able to pass it on to her friends.
All right, I'm gonna let you lead me there, Hannah. What panel are we looking for?
Six.
Here he is.
You see
him? Right there.
Hold on, keep your finger there.
That's the one I'm looking for.
Right here, I'll show you. That's him.
Okay, do you want to put your phone up to his name?
Where is it now?
What other one, right here.
Joe Soto, the guy I was saying, first guy I met, you know, after the ambush, I never saw his face again.
Soto. Right, Soto. Yeah, okay.
Okay, ready?
I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah, I got it.
You got it?
Yeah.
That's the first guy I met when I got to my unit. Kind of broke me in for showing me where the blankets were and everything.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because
yeah.
You're a newbie. They
yeah.
Kind of treat you like a newbie.
Yeah.
Thanks for not making me cry.
Oh, honey, I'm not
going
to. I wasn't going to cry. I've been here before. Didn't cry then. You cry in here.
Yeah.
You cry inside.
Being here in front of the names inscribed in granite.
Oh. Right there is my cousin.
You got it, man.
Edwin J., yep, Junior.
Reflecting on those who never made it home.
I could not do it before.
Still can.
Can be overwhelming.
He was, 22. He was on patrol in Vietnam. Marine mortars came in front of him and behind him. And he was just full of shrapnel. And he passed away. And that's the reason I really wanted to come on the honor flights, to see my cousin's name, so. Yeah, hard to believe, 22 years old, so.
For those who won't come here or can't make it to see it with their own eyes, technology is bridging the gap.
The
good
Whoa,
fit.
Oh, look at that. Once they're on. Yeah, I feel like I'm there. That is
That's
really
the point.
Cool. The goggles turn the real world into a virtual one. The clouds really are moving. Look at that. Beneath that partly cloudy sky is the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington, D.C. So how close can I get to it?
You can actually lean right in, too.
Oh, look at that. Right there are the names of the fallen. Thousands of them fill the panels, row after row, top to bottom.
We had one guy that, you know, he actually tried to physically reach out and touch the name that he found. That was kind of a tearjerker.
Sure, I can yeah, see why. Well, and that's something you see when you go to the war.
Right.
You see people touching the names. Lucas Richmond has never been to the wall, but Chad Knutson has.
Being at the wall always gives me chills.
Together, the co-workers at Gilbane Building Company came up with this virtual reality experience.
Here's your controller.
Thank you.
Using video game technology and information found online, Lucas mapped the wall. The names, the panel numbers. Oh, there's the Washington Monument.
Yep, there it is.
It's all there. With only a controller, a computer, and a pair of goggles, the user can visit the virtual wall from anywhere in the world.
That's the true power of like VR, is to be able to take someone, put them somewhere at some time.
Right. Lucas knows the power. He designs virtual reality projects for a living. So your job here at Gilbane is to create a VR, virtual reality experience for a client.
Yes.
So they can see what their building will look like, yep, or what their condo will look like.
Yeah, and like where we're gonna put the crane. We create like an entire visualization of a construction site.
The idea to put his know-how to use for veterans came from his wife after her grandfather took an honor flight.
And it obviously resonated with me.
How do you envision this being used?
The genesis was for veterans that were too sick to fly.
The technology can give ill veterans a chance to see the wall without making the trip, but it also fills another need.
Okay. For example, with the Vietnam vets.
It's powerful. It really does give you a very personal connection.
Some of them are a little more hesitant to fly because they don't know if they emotionally could handle the experience of the wall.
Whether you're seeing the wall in Washington, D.C. or seeing the wall through this experience, we're seeing the names. For those of us who were there, we know the person, the people behind this.
Yeah, I see him. Severiano Rios. He was Army and I was Marines, and we were friends through middle school and high school.
With some of the things the VA is doing with exposure and immersive therapy for PTSD, this is kind of an immersive experience to give Vietnam veterans the confidence to be able to go.
It's always tough when you see the names.
And they've done demonstrations locally, like this one, for doctors and veterans in Milwaukee.
Especially in our world of where PTSD and the sense of avoidance of those triggers, where this would be a major trigger for many of those Vietnam veterans, which would allow them to heal, to process that memory.
Chad and Lucas see the possibilities and the urgency to get it out there.
I was going out there on a Friday night and he passed on Friday morning, so I missed the opportunity to help him, but that helped us now to be able to react quickly to the next one. So hopefully we'll be able to, you know, give some veterans, you know, a positive experience, you know, for the time that they have left if they can't go.
With the support of their employer, they hope to get the virtual experience to honor flight chapters around the country.
I never thought in a million years when I was going to school for this that this would be something I could help with, you know, our build. So yeah, it's been amazing.
How far do you want to take this?
I would like to do all the memorials to see an impact of a video game on, you know, a veteran to help them kind of with their closure. It's been amazing.
More amazing moments are on the way. When a mission of thanks returns, we'll take you back to Washington.
God bless America.